Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing."
Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise."
He said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son," and to the disciple, "Here is your mother."
Jesus cried out in a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Jesus said, "I am thirsty."
Jesus said, "It is finished."
Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit."
Yeah, love that. Love hearing our staff kids reading the scriptures there. Hey, listen, I just want to tell you, I know where some of you are at. Growing up, I hated Easter because I had to go to church with my parents. And I was forced to go to church when I was a kid. And then when I got old enough, I said, enough of that. That's enough of that. I'm going to go do my own thing. I don't want to go to church anymore. So I stopped going to church, and 358, your pizza is ready. So, no, but anyway, but every Easter, my mom and dad, you know, the guns would come out, and yes, I'll go. So I'd go to Easter, and I'd sit there and listen to this guy talk forever, and it's like, when is it going to be over? Hopefully, we'll make this as painless for you as possible. We should be out of here in about 30 minutes. I want to talk to you today about the last two words of Christ at the cross. In fact, for the last 6 weeks, we've been talking about the last last seven sayings of Christ on the cross, and they were all about what was important to him as he was dying on the cross for us. And as the kids read, you know, what was important to him is forgiving people. And today, part of the message is on finishing well, because we want to finish well in life, and Jesus finished well. How did he finish well? He forgave. Family was important. Mother, here's your son. Son, handing the responsibility of his mother over to his disciple John. And then friendship, you know, even at death, he's extending friendship to this thief on the cross. And that just signifies the promise that we have that God would extend friendship to anyone at any time. And that he would extend friendship to you, regardless. I mean, I don't know how many of you have been are thieves that would be, you know, crucified on a cross, but Jesus extended friendship to him. And then the fight, just to fight for our lives, how much he cares for us and how much he loves us. And today I want to talk to you about I was inspired by the last two sayings of Christ, and I want to combine those today into one message. And he said, "It is finished." And then he said, "Into your hands, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And so we want to finish life with faith like Jesus. But I was inspired with the two points, and so here they are. Point one is to infinity, and point two is and beyond. And this movie, I'm telling you, I was so glad when this movie came out that I had two younger kids, because it gave Joni and I an excuse to go to it. It's a little awkward when you and your wife are having a date night at a cartoon. But I loved Toy Story. It came out in 1995. My son Brooks was about 9 years old, and Chad was about seven. And I mean, how could you cast Tom Hanks any better than Woody? I don't know. Did anybody see the movie? I feel like there's, yeah? Raise your hand if you saw the movie. All right, raise your hand if you cried when Old Yeller died. All right. But anyway, so, I mean, I love this movie. It's as good as it gets. It's funny, it's rich, it's meaningful. Tom Hanks as Woody, and then Tim Allen as Buzz Lightyear. Come on. To infinity and beyond. That is as good as it gets. And that's really what the point is today about the message, is that when Jesus is on the cross, the second to the last thing that Jesus said is basically to infinity. Because he uses these very powerful words in John chapter 19, verse 30. And he says these very simple words. He says, "It is finished." Now you'd think that if Jesus said it is finished, that would be the last thing he would say. But Jesus said one more thing after he said, "It is finished." I would think that when he said, "It is finished," that would be the end of it. But like so many ministers who have like nine different conclusions, you know, they say in conclusion, you're like, praise God, and then they go on another 20 minutes. I won't do that now. Most ministers need to be in a support group called On and On and On. Okay? But hopefully you won't feel that way today. But Jesus said, it is finished. Why did he say it is finished? He said, it is finished, not I am finished. Because he wasn't done. But it was finished. The reason he wasn't done is he had one more thing to do while he was on the cross before. And the Bible says he gave up his spirit. They didn't take his life. They didn't kill Jesus. He gave his life. But he said, it is finished, not I am finished. And what is the it that he's referring to? The job he was sent to do. The primary reason Jesus came was to pay for my sins. Now, he paid for yours as well, but I know he paid for mine. And that's the primary reason Jesus came, was me. And if I were the only one, he would have done the same. But he died and came to pay for all of our sins. The word finished is a banking term in the Greek, telestion. It's a banking term that means paid in full. So he's actually speaking almost financially here. But it's paid in full with a twist. See, if you bought a car, you have so many payments you have to make, and then once it's paid off, it's done. You don't have to make any more payments. I didn't know if you knew that. I usually don't keep a car long enough to own it. I just exchange it with the bank for another one, right? But this is with a twist. It means paid in full, but in perpetuity. It's almost as if Jesus not only paid for all that was done, but he left money on the accounts to be drawn on forever. An endless payment. Why is that important? See, if Jesus is on the cross and he's dying for our sins, and he says paid in full, well, what about the sins that are going to be committed? And trust me, there were sins that were going to be committed because I'm going to be born in a couple thousand years. And I have sinned twice. Two or three times. And so, what about those? If he just paid it in full, was that just for everybody that was born before? No, it's in perpetuity. It's an endless payment. The payment is for all the sin amassed for man, past, present, and future. So he's saying on the cross, I'm taking care of all the debt. All the debt that mankind raises. Now, some people say, well, I don't have any debt. Well, we could talk to somebody. I mean, I don't think any of us would like to see the CNN crew pull up to our house with all the cameras and tapes, and then they go and interview everybody that we worked for or that worked for us or that we've been friends with. Or I wouldn't want anybody digging that closely into my past because they would find something. And so we all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Jesus paid for all of it. So no matter what you've done, no matter when it occurred, and no matter how many sins, they're always covered. That's what Jesus said when he said, it is finished. All the payment necessary. There's enough on the account to cover it all. Forever. It's an ending never payment. It's an ending never payment so that we all have the opportunity to live never ending. I want to live never ending. But I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. That's point two. That's beyond. So the payment is for infinity. So we can live beyond. Christ died for sins once for all. For all. All sins. To bring you to God. The whole mission of Jesus. Pay for our sins. He finished the job. And that's what he meant by it is finished. The job is done. I want to finish life well. I want to finish life well. Just this morning in my devotions, I'm reading in Acts chapter 7. And I'm reading about this man named Stephen. Stephen wasn't one of the original disciples. Okay, there was the 12 disciples, Peter, James, John, all those guys. Judas Iscariot was one of them, you know, and then he, you know. But then, as the church grew, the disciples couldn't handle all the workload from how how big the church was getting. And so they hired some staff, so to speak. They brought on seven other men to help them with the administrating of the church. And one of them was this guy named Stephen. And Stephen was just, he was full of wisdom. Stephen had, he was a sharp man. God was using him greatly. There were things that were happening in his life and for people and ministry. And it ticked some people off. They were jealous of the power that he had and the authority that he had when he spoke. And so they put him on trial. They lied about him and they put him on trial. And while on trial, he said some things that made these church folks really mad. And let me tell you something about church folks. Some of the religious people can get really mad and judge and very judgmental. And that's what happened. And they took Stephen out and they started throwing rocks at him. It's called stoning. That's when being stoned had a different meaning. Okay? So Stephen was being stoned. He wasn't getting stoned. There's a difference. But while he's being stoned, here's how he finishes life as he's dying. Father, you're into your hands. He echoes the words of Jesus. I commit my spirit. Take me home, Lord. And then he does this thing to finish well. The second thing. He says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Oh, wow. Man, to finish like that. To finish as a man of faith or a woman of faith in God, to finish life that way, that's finishing well. That's my goal in life, is to finish that way. And then to finish being a forgiver. You want to have a lot of people at your funeral? You want to have a lot of people at your side when you die? You want to have a lot of people mourning, legitimately sorry that you died? Be a forgiver. Be a person of faith. Because you'll have plenty of friends. You'll have plenty of people around that will miss you. But man, let me tell you, if you're bitter and unforgiving, not many people are going to want to be your buds unless you got a lot of money. Then they're going to want to hang around and hope they're in the will. I want to finish well. I want to finish well, but what do I need to know to finish well in life? Because I think, what do you hear on a Sunday morning? If you don't want to finish life well, we all do. Well, you got to know where the finish line is, and you got to know what the rules are. One of the things that drives me absolutely crazy, one of them, I mean, there's many things that drive me crazy. Some people say it's not a drive, it's more of a short putt. But anyway, one of the things that drives me crazy is some of the prima donna athletes that you see on TV sometimes. Does that drive you nuts? I'm watching a football game because I like football. I'm watching a football game, and I'm not going to tell you who the receiver was, but he was playing for a team that rhymes with the Philadelphia Eagles. And the quarterback throws this beautiful pass, lays it right in the guy's basket, right? He catches it, and because this guy's fast, nobody caught him. And he is running down the sidelines to the end zone. And as he's running in his celebration at the 5-yard line, he spikes the ball. Now, that's not called a touchdown. That's called a fumble. There was nobody near him. But he celebrated at the 5. You better know where the finish line is if you want a touchdown. The 5-yard line is not the finish line. It was such a bonehead move. They did not get a touchdown because the other team fumbled. The guys that were chasing him saw an opportunity to land on the ball because they realized he had not crossed the end zone. The poor official standing there going, nope, I can't. It's not a touchdown. You got to know where they by the rules, you're not going to finish well. So those are two very important questions if you want to finish well. The goal, finishing well, is to live forever in heaven with God. I know that sounds selfish, but I can be when it comes to my life. I want to live forever. That's my goal. I want to live with Jesus. Just like the thief on the cross. He's dying. He's been mocking Jesus. He is with everybody else, making fun of Jesus, saying, maybe even cussing him out. And then he kind of like wakes up on the cross and says, hey, wait a minute. I think this guy is the Messiah. And he says, hey, can I go with you and be with you in paradise? And Jesus turned to him and said, this day you'll be with me. Yes. I want to finish like that. I want to live forever, just like that thief on the cross. That's my goal in life. The rules, according to Scripture, to finish well is faith and following. Putting your faith in God and then following His guidelines. Faith and following, those are the rules. The goal, to live forever in heaven. The rules, doing things the way God says. So it's His heaven, so it's His rules. It's not your rules. If I invited you to come over to my house, or let's say you wanted to come over to my house, you come in my house, hey, good to have you. Would you like a cup of coffee? Let's sit down, we'll have a chat. We sit down in my living room, have a cup of coffee, and you pull out a pack of Marlboros. Look, I'm not going to judge you for smoking. But it's my house. You're not going to smoke those in my house. I'm sorry. Well, wait, what's wrong with cigarettes? Nothing, man. It's your right to smoke, but not in my house. My house, my rules. If I was over at your house, and I just walk in, hey, how you doing? Walk over and open up the refrigerator. Hey, wait a minute there. Start rummaging through your drawers. What are you doing? I'm looking for money. I'm looking for cash, man. Look. My house, my rules. Your house, your rules. His house, His rules. He gets to determine what's right and wrong. He gets to determine what he believes or what he thinks is love to him. We don't get to decide that. That's the problem with humanity, though. That's the problem with many people. We want to make the determinations and the decisions for our own life. God's saying, fine, you can do that. But these are the determinations that I want if you want to finish well. My house, my rules. Isaiah 55:22, here's the rule. You turn to Him to be saved. That's the rule. You turn to Him to be saved. For He's God, and there's no other. Period. I want to finish well. I want the beyond. I want the beyond. And what is beyond? Here's how Jesus put it. Jesus knew there was a beyond. He said, Jesus called out in a loud voice, Father. Okay, right there, that first thing He said, Father, He's telling us there's someone out there. And Father, I knew in my household growing up, Father was the last word. Father was the boss of the house. Period. What Dad said went. And He is calling God, Father, the authority. Father, into Your hands, I commit my spirit. When it comes to the afterlife, the beyond, Jesus said, Father, into Your hands. But when it comes to the afterlife, we all have basically two choices. Here are the two choices with the afterlife. Either there's something more, there is a beyond, or there's nothing else. What else could there be? There either is an afterlife or there isn't an afterlife. There's something more or nothing left. You live your life however many years you get, whether it's 70, 80, 90, 100, 20, 25, 28, 40, whatever it is, you live, you die. It's like, I love this movie, it's called The Bucket List. I don't know if any of you saw it, but it's got Morgan Freeman and Jack Nicholson. And Jack Nicholson was a very wealthy man, and Morgan Freeman, they both were sick, and they went on this trip together, and they were flying in this jet, and Morgan Freeman, it's night, and he's looking out at the expanse of sky and the stars, and he asked Jack Nicholson if he believed in God or an afterlife. And here's what Jack Nicholson said, which is the way many people believe. Here's what Jack Nicholson said. He said, I believe you live and you die and the wheels of the bus go round and round. And that's just how a lot of people believe. So for you, if that's how you believe, that you live and you die and the wheels of the bus go round and round, then there's nothing else. So if there's nothing else, then there's no need to know anything more. Just do your best, get as much as you can, and then you're dead. And people in your life get to gather up what you gathered and then use it the way they want, as long as they can. And there's a lot of people that live their life that way and believe that there's just nothing, there's nothing more to life than this life. But if we think that there is something more, just like we have two options, either there's something more or nothing else, if you think there's something else, then you basically only have two more options again. Our options are limited. You know why? We're not the author of life. God's the author of life. We don't have multiple choice. It's basically these two. Reincarnation. That means, and there's two branches of reincarnation, by the way. I don't know if you know that. There's two branches of reincarnation. One branch of reincarnation is when you die, you come back as anything. You could come back as a bug. You could come back as a windshield. You could come back as a fire hydrant. You could come back as a dog. But you're going to come back as something. That's one branch of reincarnation. And people are included in that branch, that you could come back even as a person. Then there's another branch of reincarnation where you come back as another person. And you come back as another person, you come back as another person. So you live, you die, you're reincarnated as someone else in the hopes that you'll get it better next time. And each time that you're reincarnated, you get a little bit better and a little bit better and a little bit better and a little bit better until finally you reach utopia and you made it and you're good. That's reincarnation. It's really a cosmic do-over. Or you can believe in resurrection. And that's this. Jesus did it. There's no need to come back and do it over because it was done well. He finished well. So, I mean, if you're, maybe there's some folks out there, you know, the tinfoil hat people that believe there's a couple other options, and that would be maybe alien abduction is an option for you, or zombie apocalypse could be an option. I don't know, but I'm just being real here. People believe in, it's either you're coming back as something else, or you just trust that Jesus did it right the first time. Those are our beliefs. But whatever you decide, and you should make this decision, I don't think you should leave it up to chance. I don't think when it comes to life, your life, a coin toss is good enough. At least it's not for mine. I'm telling you, I love me so much that I am not going to leave my future up to a coin toss. Heads you win, tails you lose. You ready? Hold on. Is there any other information we can get here before we flip this coin? See, I don't want to base the decision of my afterlife on an opinion, on a cross your finger and hope to die. You know, no. I don't want to cross my fingers on this. I want to know the truth. As rough as it could be. What is the truth to my existence? And to my afterlife. Last summer, my father died. I don't want to just think that was it. Well, he lives on through you. Yes, he does, man. My dad lives through me, lives on through me. But he lives on with Jesus. That's my belief. Ecclesiastes 3:11. And we're getting pretty close to wrapping up. So just hang in with me for another few minutes and, man, you're eating tater salad later. He has made everything beautiful in its time. These are the words of Solomon. But look at this. See, when every person on planet Earth is born, three things are given them. One is a gift. You get a father gift of some kind. Some get multiple father gifts. A father gift is this. Just You didn't even have to try. You're just good at math. There's just some people, man, they just get numbers. I don't get it. Then there's some people that just get language. They just get words. I can understand that a little bit better. There's some people that they're just gifted in music. They can just play an instrument. And it's just it's like it just comes so easy. And you know, others have to struggle and work and struggle and work to play an instrument. And then this other guy just picks it up. And next thing you know, he's playing five instruments. Not fair. That's a father gift. Is when you hear words like because of what they do, you go, that's not fair. I mean, there's just some people that have been father gifted with athletic skills and abilities. And there's some people that have been gifted with financial understanding. And they can just understand. They understand money, and they do get degrees and education in it, but it's just so easy for them. That's a father gift. God not only put a father gift in all of us, but he also wrote and gave us a conscience. Every human being, and this I'm going to touch on this next week, because one of the things that's an obstacle to your happiness is your guilt. We all have a guilty conscience to some degree or level. That came from God. God put a conscience in every one of you and all of us, and it's very hard to shake. It's very hard to get rid of that conscience. But it's a gift, because it's the guilty conscience that leads us to Jesus. If we didn't have a guilty conscience, we wouldn't know we needed God. So that's a gift. The other thing that God gave us, we all were born with, is this notion or idea or belief that there's something more out there. That all come from him. Because he made us, he's the creator, it's his rules. His house, his rules. And so God set eternity in your heart. And you can try to shake it, you can try to numb it and dumb it down so you don't hear it anymore, but it's echoing inside your heart. There's more, there's more, there's more, there's more. There's something more, there's something more, there's something more. And you try to make yourself so busy, and you try to do all kinds of things, and you try to buy this and buy that and go here and go there and eat this and eat that and just, you know, go, 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 because you want to quiet this in, but it's still at night, you lay your head down and it's echoing, there's more. There's more to life. There's more. There's more than money. There's more than fame. There's more than, you know, there's more out there. What is it? I want to finish well. Jesus entrusted faith. He said, God, I give into your hands, I commit my spirit. He entrusted his life to God. Now, we're going to shift gears, because now I'm going to get personal with you. To whom or to what do you entrust your life to? Because you are entrusting your life to someone. Right now, it may be your own ideas and your own thoughts and your own beliefs. So you're entrusting your life to you. We should talk to people in your life. That's not wise. I would never want to trust me with my decisions. I need outside help. To whom or to what are you entrusting your life to right now? And is it going to work? Will it cause you to finish well and be in heaven with your goal to live forever? God created mankind to be with him. We chose to go. Like I said, when I was in high school and college, I hated Easter Sunday because I had to go to church. So I know where some of you are at. You just would rather be anywhere but here, but you know, you're going to keep the peace in the family and show up. But here, if you hear anything, we chose to go. I chose to go. But out of his great love, God said, I'm going to help you come back to me. I'm going to send Jesus, and he's going to lead you back. The whole mission of Jesus to come from cradle to the cross was to help us find our way back to God. Hey, follow me, guys. He's this way. He's this way. He said it himself in John 14:6. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. He's telling everybody, follow me, follow me. I chose to come back to God years ago. 38 years ago, on May 11th. On May 11th, it'll be 38 years, I chose to come back to God. I know I was like 3. But I'd had a hard life. I chose to come back to God, and this required some things of me. One, I had to believe in God. How do you do that? Well, first of all, you say it. God, I believe in you. And then you live like you believe in God. And that's what faith is. I believe in God. I've used this analogy so many times, but all of you have operated in belief this morning. Your belief turned to faith. Every one of you. Every one of you have operated in faith this morning, and that's because you're sitting down. How'd you know that chair was going to hold you? Was that a guess? You've seen it before. You recognize what a chair looks like. You, in your intellect, you go, that can support my weight, even mine. And so you believe that, and so you go, yeah, and you sit down without even thinking. You're operating in faith right now. Faith is you take knowledge and you put it to practice. Truth to practice becomes faith. And then I asked Jesus to forgive me of my sins on that day. And I have, since that day, sinned, like I said, two or three times. And I've had to ask Jesus to forgive me of all those. And I do. I just stay in regular communication with Jesus about my sin. And then I confessed him as my Savior. That's it. It's not a lot more complicated than that. We will all trust our lives to someone. You are trusting your life to someone. I want you to know God's just an ask away. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. Justified is a legal term. Here's the best way to understand justified. I look at it this way when I read it. It's justified, never sinned. When I ask God to forgive me, it's justified, never sinned at all. I'm justified. And it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. I'd like you to bow your heads, and I want to ask you this question. Will you entrust your life to God? Will you do what I've done? Put your faith in God, believe in Him, ask Him to forgive you, and then confess Him as your Lord and Savior. And if you will do that this morning, with everybody's heads bowed and eyes closed, I would ask you just to slip your hand up so I know who I'm praying with. Yep, good decisions. Good, 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 good. Look, these decisions, this is the greatest decision of your life. You're ensuring, just like the thief on the cross, you're basically saying, I want to be with you, God. I want to live forever. So just ask Him. You say, well, I don't know how to pray. If you know how to talk, you know how to pray. All prayer is talking, but it's to someone. You're talking now to God, your Father in heaven. And just like Jesus said, Father, in your hands I commit my spirit. You're saying, Father, I commit my life to you. I commit my sins. I ask you to forgive me. It's just, He's just an ask away. And then the relationship is developed through communication. You just talk to Him. Because He loves you so much. When we get to heaven, we'll realize how much God loves us, and we'll go, oh God. It'll just evoke worship from us that He loves us this much. Father, thanks for dying, not just dying, but showing that death is nothing, has no hold on you. And so therefore, because I believe in you, death has no hold on me. I will live beyond, to infinity and beyond. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, I'm Pastor Chad, one of the staff pastors here at the Foothills Church. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed it, please subscribe to our channel. Also, you can donate with this link down in the bottom or go to our website, thefoothillschurch.org.